The sitting is resumed. It is time for questions to the Minister of Finance and Personnel, and we will start with listed questions. And can I point out that question number 2 has been withdrawn? I call Mr. Pat Ramsey. Mr. Ramsey.
Question 1, Deputy Speaker.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, I am pleased to say that Land Property Services remain on target to deliver the new values that will be used in non-domestic rates bills from 1 April 2015 onwards. LPS has already completed draft valuations of all 72,500 non-domestic rateable properties in Northern Ireland. Individual values will continue to be refined by LPS valuers over the coming weeks, and a breakdown of their evaluation effects by sector and by council will then be available based on the new 11 district council areas. Figures showing the effects of the revaluation at a constituency level are therefore not available at this stage. In many ways, the effects of the revaluation will not be fully understood until new district and regional rate poundages are known.
Mr. Ramsey, for supplement.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I thank the Minister for his response and also for responding very quickly to my request for a meeting which is taking place next week with some of the traders. One of the fundamental concerns of the retailers within the walled city is that within yards outside that walled city, literally outside the walls, some of the retailers in the same square foot accommodation are paying much less, and it's trying to give them the justification why they're paying exorbitant rates within the city centre, the walled city. If the Minister would give any explanation.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, I think the member and I are meeting next Monday, I think, is the date for the meeting, and he's bringing some traders from Londonderry along to have a conversation, and I hope to, on one hand, explain why things are the way they are and perhaps give a little hope that the revaluation may be an answer for some of, if not all, of those traders. The purpose of the revaluation, as the House will appreciate, isn't to increase the overall rates take across Northern Ireland, it is to get a fairer balance. So it is almost exactly the sort of situation, Deputy Speaker, that the member talks about, where traders in one part of a city or in one town maybe think that they are being disadvantaged compared to traders in or businesses in another part of the city or indeed in another town. And whilst there are no guarantees for Londonderry, as there are no guarantees for Oughtnards or any part of Northern Ireland, you would expect where rates or where rent on the basis of April 2013 is below the average of what it was at that in terms of the increases between back to the early part of the century. You would expect rateable values to go down and the converse in terms of people going up. There will be some winners, there will be some losers, and there will be many who will remain the same. And it's too early to say what the situation will be in the member's constituency or indeed any constituency, but what is developing at this early stage, Deputy Speaker, is that it looks that the value of the list has increased by somewhere between 5% and 10%, and that there are certain towns that will do better than others, and there are certain parts of towns that will do better than others. And we would expect, and we indeed anticipated this with a large retail levy, that those sort of edge and out-of-town shopping centres will see a significant increase in their rateable value, and perhaps then to balance that out, there will be some town centres, although not all, that will see their rateable values go up.
Mr. Gregory Campbell.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Just on the issue of winners and losers and town centres, can the Minister outline that where there are losers, particularly in urban centres, small traders and shop owners, in those locations where they have lost out significantly, will there be any hardship assistance for instances like that?
One of the things that I, and indeed my predecessor, because he was the minister who initiated the revaluation some years ago, we've been at pains to stress at all times, is that there will be winners, there will be losers, and there will be many who will remain the same. That's something that we have tried to communicate consistently. I am not, I have to say, convinced that message has always gotten through. I think there are some who, some in business who believe that, to borrow the First Minister's word from yesterday, the revaluation will be a panacea for all of their problems, and I'm afraid the news for some will be that it won't be a panacea. There will be some who will see their rateable values go up. As I said in response to the original question from Mr. Ramsey, we won't know, even if somebody's rateable value goes up, we will not know whether that means an increased rates bill in the previous year until both the councils and ourselves strike our elements of the district and regional rate respectively. Given that there will be some people who will see a hit and an increase, it is something that in the past certainly we would have introduced a transitional relief scheme. Doing a transitional relief scheme at this time is going to be complicated by the fact that there are mergers of councils. So the member's own constituency is based in an area where there are four councils coming together. So how you would actually work out what an accurate transitional relief, the basis upon which you would work that out, is complicated by the fact that you're merging all of these different councils on different rates. So our convergence rates convergence scheme that we will put in place, and I will announce the details of that shortly, may deal with some of the problems. We are reviewing the small business rates relief scheme as well, and I'm waiting for the Northern Ireland Centre of Economic Policy, Deputy Speaker, to come back with the conclusions on that. That will assist some losers as well, and we will, if necessary, and it needs to be on the basis of what actually comes forward finally in terms of where the valuations are. I am open to looking at a scheme that would deal with those rate payers that are worst affected on the basis of an analysis of how many there are and to what extent they are worse off.
Call Mr. Alex Maskey.
Could I ask the Minister, although he may have referred or at least alluded to this in the last response here, but can I ask the Minister, can he actually review the rates relief scheme just so as we can make sure that we do maximise the survival rates for businesses, particularly in light of the ongoing financial difficulties?
Yeah, the Small Business Rates Relief Scheme, which has now been in existence for a number of years and has been extended twice in its lifetime, to the point, Deputy Speaker, where over half, with it and other support that we are offering as an executive to business rate payers, over half of all business properties in Northern Ireland are getting at least 20% off their rates bill. And that I think, is something that this House should be immensely proud of. I think it was right that we stepped in when we did, and we introduced the support that we did. And there are many businesses in Northern Ireland that are still trading, in part because of the help that we have been able to offer them in terms of rates relief. It was introduced as a recessionary measure. It was there to get businesses through the very difficult years that we have been through and we're now starting to emerge out of. And whilst I think there are arguments, that very clear arguments, that we are in economic recovery, I don't think that is uniform. It is patchy. There are certain sectors, including retail, which is one of the main beneficiaries of small business rates relief, which are still struggling. And I think we'll need some further support to see them through at least another year, if not indeed further. So that's why I initiated the, rather than as a legislation required, bringing the scheme to an end, commissioned a review to be carried out by the Northern Ireland Centre for Economic Policy. They have been engaging in consultation over the last number of months. I'm due to get their report very soon, and I will need to bring back the conclusions to the executive and to this place very quickly thereafter, so that if we want to extend the scheme or change the scheme slightly or adapt it, that we can have that in place for April of next year and help out some more businesses at the end of the recession.
Call Mr. Phil Flanagan for a question.
Mr. Speaker, the government has not yet formally set out any proposals for enhanced devolution for Scotland. So, no, I haven't requested at this stage a meeting with Her Majesty's Treasury.
Sorry, I called Mr. Flanagan for a supplementary.
I'll ask you, Curley, perhaps the Minister will notice that it was briefed on the pre-referendum proposals, but anyway. Can I ask the Minister if he accepts that it would be helpful to publish an independent comparison of the measures on welfare reform for Scotland with what's proposed for this region, and an independent comparison of the two measures?
I was before the Finance Committee last Wednesday, and over the course of the session, one of the issues that kept repeatedly coming up was the plethora of information from a range of sources around welfare reform, whether they be governmental sources here in Northern Ireland or governmental sources in London, or indeed charities or other organisations who have produced various analysis into the effects of welfare reform on Northern Ireland. And the very clear message coming from the committee was that it would be important that perhaps me as Minister of Finance commission a piece of work that came up with an authoritative view on what the effects were. That was something that I had myself been thinking about. It was something indeed that the executive had discussed but hadn't been taken forward collectively by the executive. So it's something that I am prepared and content to do, to try to and I think if it would be done in the spirit, Deputy Speaker, I hope it would be received as such, as an independent authoritative view on best estimate, given the figures that are there and the complexities that there are within of what the effects, both good and bad, would be, what the costs are, what the cost of an IT system, et cetera, might be. So that's a piece of work that I'm going to do. And of course, within that, there is a scope to look at what's happening elsewhere, what may happen in Scotland. I think it's important to note that whilst many things have been promised to the people of Scotland, it is not yet clear what they are absolutely going to get. And on first analysis and first reading, from my perspective, what was an offer to the Scottish people in terms of welfare, it didn't strike me as massively dissimilar to what we have in terms of having legislative devolution and authority for welfare. But any changes that wanted to be made, any differentiation from parity, would come at a cost to the Scottish people, and they would have to find that money for themselves. That, Mr. Deputy Speaker, is exactly what we have at the minute. That is what is causing us problems at this minute. And for us to do anything over and above what the Scottish may or may not get has to be viewed in that perspective of that there is clearly not the maturity in this place to take some very difficult decisions with the powers that we have, never mind getting additional ones.
Call Mr. Danny Kinahan.
Thank you very much, Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his answer so far. And yesterday, the First Minister gave us an indication of one or two areas of fiscal measures he was looking for. But does the Minister have a draft shopping list of enhanced devolution measures that he would like to see in Northern Ireland? Could he elaborate on what they might be?
I think in this debate and this discussion, I mean, there are some in this House, and we know who they are, who want to take a very maximalist approach, Deputy Speaker, to the devolution of fiscal powers. And my view on the devolution of any fiscal power is that it has to pass two tests. One is affordability. It's incredibly important in a region like ours, which is dependent to the tune of £10 billion a year in terms of a subvention coming from London. So it has to be affordable, and that's an incredibly difficult hurdle to pass in respect of many fiscal devolution powers of tax varying powers being devolved down to this Assembly. If you take income tax, for example, for every single percentage that you would reduce that, that would cost our block grant or cost our spending power as executive around about £90 million. The same is true with other duties and other taxes as well. There's a cost if you want to do something in terms of a downward direction. I do have a shopping list. It's a shopping list that I think all of us, with a few notable exceptions, in this House have, and at the top of that shopping list is corporation tax. And I think that whilst a discussion will naturally flow from what happened in Scotland last week, something that is continuing to be played out in the weeks and months ahead is the union, as we know it, undergoes a degree of change, driven mostly by Scotland. I think it is important that this House, the executive, and all of Northern Ireland doesn't lose sight of our number one objective, which is the devolution of corporation tax. It is a sizeable, chunky, costly power to devolve, but it comes with, I believe, considerable benefits. We must continue to focus on corporation tax. I think we are this close to actually getting those powers, and we shouldn't be distracted away by chasing sort of moonbeams like income tax or VAT, which we can't legally get, or some other powers which we might be able to get, might be able to take, but wouldn't have the transformative economic effect the corporation tax would have.
Well, Mr. Kieran McCarthy.
Mr. Speaker, and I'm glad the Minister mentioned corporation tax. Does the Minister agree that a lower rate of corporation tax by itself will not be effective in isolation, and that we would need to invest in other drivers such as skills to take us into the future?
I wonder why the member in particular might highlight skills as something that might need future investment. He is right. If we get the power, and I do believe we are incredibly close to getting the power now that the Scottish referendum is out of the way, there is no excuse, in my view, for the Prime Minister to delay in giving us a clear indication that we will get the power. It is then over to us in many respects, not just in terms of passing our own legislation in this House, but getting ourselves ready for that time whenever, in a few years' time, whenever we would have a significantly lower corporation tax rate. And it was never about just having a significantly lower rate of corporation tax. Work would need to be done in advance to ensure that we were ready for that moment, that we could seize the opportunity that lower corporation tax would have in Northern Ireland. And of course that will require continued and perhaps even increased investment in certain areas, such as what Invest Northern Ireland does in terms of projecting a positive image of Northern Ireland as a place to invest. You can't project that image if you don't have substance behind it. One bit of that would be, of course, lower corporation tax, and that will attract different types of companies to invest in Northern Ireland who haven't invested here before. But we've also got to ensure that if somebody comes and invests in Northern Ireland and brings 1,000 high-tech, highly skilled, high-paid jobs, that we have 1,000 people with those skills that are required to do that. So it will be an incredibly challenging situation where, on the one hand, we are reducing our public spending because of the cost of corporation tax, which could be in excess of £300 million a year and rising, but at the same time still needing to invest. And that's why it's silly for some in this House who want to pursue corporation tax, who are supportive of the evolution of corporation tax, to fritter away then tens and tens and ultimately hundreds and hundreds of millions of pounds paying welfare reform penalties when we're already facing budgetary challenges and we face the very real prospect of further reductions to get as a price of getting corporation tax.
Call Mr. Barry Michael Duff.
Question number 4, Keish Devarakiahar.
Deputy Speaker, with your permission, I would like to group questions 4 and 7, which relate to landlord liability, together. I'm aware of a number of cases where the landlord has taken payment from the tenant in respect of rates as part of a tenancy agreement, but not passed payment on to the department. In respect of these disputed cases, I can confirm that there has not been a recent increase in the number of instances. My department has already taken forward legislative steps to clarify the position in terms of landlord liability. Primary legislation was introduced earlier this year to remove complex tenancy criteria from legislation. I will also be taking forward new legislation later in the year to standardise landlord allowances. Both changes arose from public consultation last year. I have also asked my officials to look into the issue next year with a view to more fundamental reform. This is a difficult area and we need to be careful we do not stray too far from the principle that rates are a charge for services as well as a local tax. Deputy Speaker, the current arrangements, however, do confuse, hence the need for a radical rethink. In doing so, it is important that other changes affecting landlords, such as direct payment of housing costs under universal credit, are taken into account.
Mr. Michael Duff for supplementary.
Can I thank the Minister for his reply? And can I further ask the Minister if he accepts that the current valuation threshold may be set too high to provide appropriate protection for tenants?
The current threshold of 150,000 of a capital value was amended and increased and was actually on the basis of the last domestic revaluation, which is around 2006-2007. And it was set a little higher. It probably should have been a little lower, but it was increased and set at 150,000. And the reason it was set at 150,000, Deputy Speaker, was that it was found on analysis that it was houses of or properties with a lower capital value where there was a much more transient population, and therefore there was difficulty sometimes in finding rating liability, whereas those over the threshold, over the £150,000, tended to be properties that were rented by people who remained in situ for a much longer period in time. Now, you could move that figure up, you could move that figure down. I think the essential issue here is that having a threshold, wherever it is apparently for a small number of people, and it is a small number of people, but in accepting that it's a small number of people, I don't deny that it is an incredibly traumatic experience for those people when they go through it and they believe that they have paid their rates and find out that actually they haven't and the liability is still there. So I'm not so much focused, Deputy Speaker, on what the threshold is. It is whether now, as part of what I outlined there in the initial response to the member, whether we should have a threshold at all.
Well, Mr. Sidney Anderson.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his responses thus far. Minister, you have touched on the issue of bringing in legislation to maybe close this loophole, but can I ask what information or what advice you could give to those who are maybe caught, although they are small numbers, to those people who have been caught in this situation and possibly to those going forward in the future who hope to move into the private rental sector?
The one thing that I would say to the legislation is clear, but perhaps not well understood. The 1977 order, Section 20, makes it clear that responsibility lies in the situation where the capital value is less than 150,000, lies, Deputy Speaker, with the tenant to pay the rates bill. And I know that the Department, Land and Property Services, have attempted to communicate that in various ways and through the landlord representatives and so on, and so on, the housing rights service as well. But it's clear that perhaps the message isn't always getting through to the people who need to get it. What I will say is that if, in those rare circumstances where it comes up as an issue, I know many members of this House have raised various individual cases with me in the past, Land and Property Service will be as attempt to be as understanding as they possibly can within the legal position as it currently stands, and will try to work with people to ensure that the rates are repaid and are paid in a flexible and a sensible way as possible. But what I would say is that, you know, that is the current position. There are some changes going through this year, as I've outlined, but I am keen at looking at perhaps a more radical approach and a more radical rethink to ensure that this type of a problem, whether they're small in volume or not, actually doesn't arise in the future at all.
Well, Mr. Robin Swan.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his answer. The Minister will be aware that if a property valued between £55,000 and £150,000, if the rent is paid quarterly, the landlord is liable for rates, but if it's paid monthly, the tenant is liable for rates. Has any intention of changing that in legislation, or even to make tenants more liable or more aware of that anomaly?
Basically, Deputy Speaker, it's a subject which has clearly provoked a lot of interest around the House, and is something that, if volume of correspondence and queries via the committee have anything to go by, it is something that I think there is a mood for us to do something in respect of. And what I'm, I suppose, in broad sweeping terms, is what I'm keen to do is look at the situation where we remove any doubt whatsoever from the situation. It will always be the case, irrespective of how rent is paid or what the capital value of the property is, that it is always the landlord who would be responsible. Now, I say that in terms of a general policy direction. I think there are issues that have to be considered very carefully before we end up potentially in that destination, because it would be, as I said earlier in response to Mr. McElduff, a fundamental change in the principle, one of the underpinning principle of rates, which is that it is a payment for services, it is not a payment for the property itself. That's something we've got to be very careful about breaking that principle. And I've also, I think, because of that and because of the fundamental shift that it would be, we have to consult very carefully, Deputy Speaker, with particularly landlord interests to ensure that whilst they may not be sympathetic or supportive, and most landlords do a good job and do what they are meant to do, but that they understand the reasons why we are thinking about heading in that particular direction.
Mr. Roy Beggs for a question.
Question number 5.
Deputy Speaker, with your permission, I would like to answer questions 5 and 14 together. The UK Government has confirmed that the Northern Ireland block allocation will be reduced by £87 million in 2014-15 for non-adherence to the Welfare Reform Initiative. Should the stalemate on welfare reform continue, this cost will be £114 million next year and will quickly escalate to over £200 million a year. Of course, this does not include the substantial cost of securing an IT system to deliver welfare payments in Northern Ireland. The Minister for Social Development has proposed a range of measures that will soften the impact of some of the most controversial aspects of welfare reform. While some of these measures will have a cost attached, it will be ultimately for the Executive to determine the level of funding it sets aside for this purpose. What I will say is that estimates of these costs are small when considered against the cost of not progressing welfare reform.
Well, Mr. Beggs, for supplementary.
Thank the Minister for his answer. But I understand the cost of mitigation to be in the order of tens of millions of pounds, and therefore would have a significant impact in our overall budget. So can the Minister explain why he attempts to solely blame the difficulties in the health service on welfare reform, rather than his failure to review the annual budget and take these very significant changes that have occurred into context in that budget and do it in a planned fashion rather than the inefficient, unplanned fashion that is happening with the cuts at present?
Mr. Deputy Speaker, it's very, very clear that the member who was sitting in the chair yesterday during a debate in the budget wasn't listening to a word that was said during that debate in the budget. It was very, very, very clear from what I said in that debate, as indeed I've been consistent throughout, that welfare reform is a problem. We have already lost £13 million from our ability to spend as a government. That's £13 million. Well, it might be a small amount in terms of the grand scheme of things. It's £13 million that could and should have been spent on public services in Northern Ireland. we are preparing to remove a further £87 million, equivalent of 2.3% of reductions to all departments excluding health and education. It is an issue that is growing and growing and growing as a problem. £114 million next year, and then into £200-odd millions of after each year after. Now, I thought that was something which the Ulster Unionist Party had some sympathy for. I thought they were supportive of my party's pressing for welfare reform legislation to be passed, but perhaps there is a new dispensation again in the Ulster Unionist Party where they are having a different position on welfare reform, having of course been the party that went to the polls in 2010 on a manifesto that actually called for the welfare reform that is currently going through. I have never denied that there are other pressures in the budget. We have basically flat cash, Deputy Speaker, in terms of our resource budget from 2010. Again, spending plans that the Tory party had in their manifesto, which of course the Ulster Unionist Party were fully signed up to in 2010. And we have a range of other departmental and executive pressures which have been building up and building up, which all add up into the difficulties that we're having with our finances. If I had welfare legislation passed and I could get that £87 million and not have to hand it over to Treasury, it wouldn't solve all of the problems that we have, Deputy Speaker, but it would go a hell of a long way to mitigating some of the worst problems that we're dealing with in our budget in this year.
Mr. Chris Hazard.
And thank the Minister for his answer to date. Given that a Scottish counterpart and indeed their colleagues in the SNP have negotiated quite extensive additional flexibilities in terms of the welfare protection in Scotland, and indeed Ivan Lewis has come out publicly today to say that the people of the North of Ireland deserve a bespoke welfare system, can I ask the Minister specifically to outline what he is doing to gain such additional flexibilities for the people of the North who are so reliant on welfare? Government.
I knew that Martin McGuinness had agreed a package on mitigating measures for welfare reform. He told us that he took it to his party and his party didn't agree, but it would be clear, Mr. Deputy Speaker, from this comment, that not everybody in the party saw what the measures were. Because a package of mitigating measures far in excess of what the Scots have got have been already negotiated by Nelson McCausland and the Minister for Social Development. A package of measures which includes ensuring that the bedroom tax, the much hated bedroom tax, does not affect anybody who is already a tenant in Northern Ireland. A series of issues and flexibilities around the payments of direct payments to landlords, split payments and more frequent payments, which is not the default position in the rest of the United Kingdom. And indeed a package of measures which had support and help for some of the most vulnerable in Northern Ireland who may have had difficulty moving from the current welfare situation to where they might be after welfare reform. And of course, let's not forget that on DSD's own estimation, the majority of people in Northern Ireland will actually be no worse off or better off as a result of welfare reform. It is less than a third of people who would be in a difficult position as a result of it all, and therefore needing not as much help as the rest of the people who would be beneficial from it all. So, you know, in terms of a situation where we should be going and asking for what Scotland has, every time I have met with the Scottish Finance Secretary, John Swinney, he has been looking to get exactly what we have. Exactly what we have. Yet there are some in this House who, whenever they have got all that they can get, whenever everybody from the Chief Secretary to the Treasury to the Secretary of State to the Deputy Prime Minister to the Prime Minister himself tell you all that negotiations have ended and that there is no more to come, still dig in and demand more when there is no more to come. We have a very attractive package which will not solve everything in respect of welfare reform but will mitigate the worst problems for people in Northern Ireland in a way that people in England, Scotland and Wales will not benefit from.
Call Mr. Jim Allister.
The Minister has explained the immense difficulties imposed by not proceeding with welfare reform, has articulated the figures, £87 million, another £214 million a year. And we've all seen the chaos that that's creating. As an enthusiast for corporation tax, how would he then ever hope to cope with a £400 million cut in the block grant if that ambition was achieved?
Look, I am and I have long been an enthusiast for the devolution of corporation tax, a position supported by almost all of the parties in this place. And I have been because of what I believe to be the right reasons. Whilst there would be a cost, absolutely, we accept there's a cost, and perhaps sometimes it's easy for some in the House to agree to the beneficial side of it, which would be somewhere between 50 and 70,000 higher paid jobs coming into Northern Ireland over the next decade. They don't always think about the downside of it, and that's something that I have been incredibly mindful of and would expect to be mindful of, and you would expect to be mindful of in the job that I am in. I accept the point that the member and the other members of the House made in the debate yesterday, that if you have a situation where you cannot deal, and we hear the sort of yelping and screaming that there has been because of the reductions in year and the reductions anticipated next year, that it does look challenging in dealing with a situation like corporation tax. And I think that whilst I am an enthusiast and I remain an enthusiast, because I think it is ultimately to the benefit of the Northern Ireland economy in terms of creating those 50 to 70,000 higher paid, higher skilled jobs, it does require a degree of maturity on the part of some within this House, which has up to this point, Deputy Speaker, not been on show, because it will necessitate sizeable reductions to public spending in Northern Ireland. There are sizeable reductions required because of the position that we find ourselves in with welfare reform, and the lack of maturity on welfare reform doesn't translate well into dealing with a situation like corporation tax. But I do still remain personally committed to doing it. I think we are incredibly close to having those powers devolved to Northern Ireland, and it would be a shame if we were not able to do what we all want in this House, with a few notable exceptions, in terms of reducing corporation tax, because there is a lack of political maturity on the part of Sinn Féin and the SDLP.
Order. That ends the period for oral questions. We will now move on to topical questions. And before I call the next speaker, can I tell members that questions 5 and 6 have been withdrawn? Mr. Jonathan Craig.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Minister, the DOJ budget is facing reductions to its budget this year of over $40 million directly to the PSNI. Does the Minister understand how this tallies with the Chief Constable's public comments that the PSNI budget cuts this year are over $80 million? And can he outline to the House what reason is driving this level of cuts in DOJ?
Thank the member for his question. I know he has a particular interest, given his membership of the policing board, in this issue. And I am aware, and I have listened to at least two media reports where the Chief Constable has outlined the extent of pressures and reductions and cuts that his budget is facing in year. And I had, I suppose I took more interest in it because I didn't tally precisely with the reductions that the Department of Justice are facing in year. And the member is right to highlight that it's around 30 to 40 million of reductions that the Department of Justice budget is facing in year. The police, whilst the biggest chunk of the justice budget, is still only around 66%, I think, of the total Department of Justice budget. So what the Chief Constable is saying doesn't, on the face of it, tally with what's happening in terms of reductions in year. I am aware that there are other pressures, and the member, given his membership of the policing board, will be better aware perhaps of some of those pressures that the police particularly are facing. I think there's issues around working time directive, security, and various other issues. And there are other issues within the Department of Justice, such as legal aid, which I think are causing difficulties for the minister. I am presuming that there are issues, and I am only presuming, that the reason why there are higher cuts being outlined by the Chief Constable is that it is a reflection of what needs to be done to deal with the overall pressures within the justice family, as opposed to specific cuts being levied at the policing budget.
Call Mr. Craig for supplementary.
Mm-hmm. Minister, thank you for that answer. And you're not the only person who gets confused around policing budgets. Would you be prepared to sit down with both the Chief Constable to discuss this? And have you any comments to make around the fact that he has also outlined that next year, 1/7 of his budget, he has been asked to reduce and take out of his budget? Consequences of that are horrendous. We're talking about the parking of all historical inquiries, the end of police recruitment, and this House needs to face up to the reality. He is also discussing laying off 1,000 civilian staff. Now, that is a direct consequence of what we were discussing earlier around welfare reform.
Perhaps I should start out, Deputy Speaker, by saying that, you know, I would rather we were not passing on to the Department of Justice, the whole justice family, and particularly the police, any reductions in their spending capacity above and beyond what is necessary. I think we all accept that times are tough and there are a range of pressures, as I outlined to Mr. Beggs earlier. Hopefully he listened this time. There are a range of pressures that we are facing which will necessitate cuts across the board. I don't want to see any reductions in the police budget above and beyond what is necessary, Deputy Speaker. In terms of meeting with the Chief Constable and indeed anybody from the policing team, I'm more than happy to do that. In fact, in January of this year, I met along with the Justice Minister with the then Chief Constable, Matt Baggett. The action point out of that meeting was that we would engage as a department, the Department of Finance, at official level with officials from the Department of Justice and indeed from the police. That didn't start off in the way that I had hoped or quickly enough or at the level that I had wanted it to. It has improved and it is improving, and I hope that there will be opportunities for me to meet face to face with the Chief Constable. I'm more than happy to meet with him. I think in order for me to get a better, primarily for me to get a better understanding of exactly what is going on. And if I have a better understanding of what is going on, then it helps me in discussions with the executive and other ministers about what are real pressures, what are pressures that need our attention, and what are ones that perhaps the overall justice budget can absorb itself. So I'm more than happy to have this discussion, but the member is right to highlight that there are consequences coming, not helped by the fact that we have welfare reform penalties to pay, which are going to have a disastrous impact on justice, on policing, just as they are on health and education and other public services as well.
Ms. Katrina Rann is not in her place. I call Mr. Fergal McKinney.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and can I thank the Minister for his answers thus far? And can he tell the House what consultations and preparation preparatory work is being done ahead of the 2015-16 budget?
Mr. Deputy Speaker, back in December of last year, I think it was the 10th of December, I tabled a paper to the executive outlining at that stage, and obviously things are quite fluid and change all the time, but I pointed out at that stage what I believe the challenges were in terms of living within our means for the next financial year. It also set out a fairly extensive consultation, pre-consultation process where we could have involved a range of people from the community, from business, from voluntary sector and from various interest groups. And we could have had a gradual, slow process of building up towards a formal agreement of the budget. Unfortunately, like so much in this place, Deputy Speaker, that was unable to proceed. It wasn't taken by the executive, it wasn't examined by the executive, it wasn't discussed. It then got bogged down in the issue of welfare reform, and we quickly moved into the June monitoring situation where it was pointless in coming forward until we knew exactly what was going on with welfare reform or what wasn't going on with welfare reform. The long and the short of all of that, Deputy Speaker, is that we are now in an incredibly challenging position in respect of our 15-16 budget. Sometimes in this place there is a focus on getting the October monitoring round dealt with, and I absolutely, it is incredibly pressing. It is urgent action is required in respect of the October monitoring round, but we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that we don't have a budget in place for next year yet. And I would like, ideally, to get agreement on a draft budget by the end of this month, the start of next month, enter into a 12-week consultation with the general public, and then come back with final draft or final budget proposals by the end of this year. That's an incredibly challenging timetable. It would be challenging in any circumstances. It is exacerbated by the fact that we have all of the pressures that I was talking about before, plus 114 million of welfare penalties next year, and the potential of IT cost investment and IT costs next year as well. So there is work going on, but it is not moving at a pace that I would like, and it is imperative that the executive very quickly agree a draft budget to give a degree of certainty across departments about what next year is going to look like.
Call Mr. McKinney for supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and can I thank the Minister. In the context of the reality of all of that welfare debate, and we've had it over the last months, would it not have merit, would there not be merit in a reprioritisation within the programme for government, particularly around deprived areas, and a focus in on deprivation to help alleviate some of the deprivation in those areas and maybe take some of the weight off the welfare reform discussion?
I don't think we can avoid, as much as sometimes we would wish it all go away, the welfare reforms, we can't lose focus on the fact that we're actually arguably past decision point on this, and it is now starting to infect, we can see it starting to infect our political discourse generally, but particularly from my perspective, it is infecting our ability to do budgeting and finance properly within the Northern Ireland Executive, where, you know, we do have the need to, because the second tranche of reductions in year are related specifically to welfare reform. There may be other things that we want to fund as well in October monitoring, but $87 million has to be found to pay for the penalties. And then 114 next year on the IT costs as well. So we shouldn't lose sight or try to say that it's not an issue and we can park it. It is absolutely core and central to the problems that we are facing. In terms of the programme for government, while it's not my ministerial responsibility, other than the responsibility that I have for DFP-specific targets contained within the existing programme for government, the member might like to know that there is a mid-term review going on of our programme for government targets. They are looking at, in the context of having an additional year, rather than having a brand new, a full new programme for government, these are looking at extending existing targets and, where appropriate, introducing new targets. That's work that is ongoing, and progress is being made in developing a list of additional targets that we get added in, that some of which do reflect problems that have emerged. Many of the issues within the existing programme for government, you would just want to roll those forward because the situation hasn't largely changed. There are some things which will have developed, and ministers will want to include them as new targets that they want to try to work for in the final year of our mandate. So work is going on that respect. Perhaps it won't be to everybody's satisfaction as a fundamental redraft of the programme for government, but I think in the circumstances where we find ourselves in, where the budget is challenging, where time is pressing, I think the mid-term review and a roll forward of many of the targets and a few additional ones is the right way to go.
Call Mr. Jim Allister.
Thank you. On the 18th of November 2013, I tabled a written question to the Minister about a letter from Turkington Holdings to his department. Despite the fact that that was a priority written question, despite the fact that I have since tabled three reminder questions, the Minister so far has failed or refused to answer it. Why is the Minister showing such contempt to the processes of this House by failing to answer that question?
Yeah, I like to think that I know quite a lot about my brief. In fact, most of the brief, I'm not entirely familiar with the question that the member is particularly talking about and relating to. And if he wishes to have a word with me afterwards and give me the exact number of the question, I'll look into it and see what we can do.
I don't know how many times one has to ask the Minister, having tabled three reminder questions, but the question is AQW28360. Now, will the Minister now publicly commit to answering that question, and will he explain to the House why, despite the reminder questions and the fact it was a priority written question, he has so far refused to answer the question? What is he trying to hide?
Deputy Speaker, the member has given me the number of the question. I will do what I committed to do, and in my previous answer, I will go and I will look at it, and if I'm able to answer it, I will.
Call Mr. Roy Beggs.
The Minister previously avoided answering my question, so I'll ask them it yet again. Given that he would have known the huge pressures on the health service this year, and there have been significant costs from either welfare reform, clawbacks or mitigation, why did he not adjust the 2014-15 budget in advance?
Well, of course, the member will be well aware that the executive agreed a four-year budget. That included actually a substantial increase above and beyond what other departments had in terms of the allocations to health. And as I pointed out in the debate yesterday when the member was in the chair, and I'm not sure whether he was listening at this point or not, in spite of the warnings of doom that came from the then Health Minister Michael McGimsey about what would actually happen to the health service, and let us remind ourselves again, I will remind the member because I don't think he was listening yesterday, about the things that Michael McGimsey, his party colleague, said at that time in terms of what would happen to the health service and what actually happened in reality. He told us that there would be job losses, around 4,000 job losses would hit the health service over this budget period. In fact, Deputy Speaker, the number of nurses are up by nearly 6%. The number of medical and dental consultants are up 15%, and the number of allied health professionals are up over 12%. So there's another one area where Michael McGimsey was wrong. He also told us that hospital waiting lists would rise. In reality, the number spending longer than 12 hours in emergency departments is down by over 73% from May of 2011. And of course, he told us, at the time, famously told us, that we would be in Chapter 11 bankruptcy. by 1st of April of 2011. Now, he is in the House, and perhaps he could explain to me. I'm happy for him to explain to me afterwards why we would be filing for bankruptcy in an American court. But, of course, we didn't enter into bankruptcy. And the minister, who is looming behind his shoulder at this minute in time, found a further £500 million worth of efficiencies from the health service and has committed to finding another £170 million this year. So I think, given the doom and gloom predictions that there was an increase in health spending for this year, and the minister has done an excellent job in ensuring that those inefficiencies which were there have been extracted from the system.
Call Mr Beggs for supplementary.
The minister, in my opinion, still failed to explain why he adjusted what could easily have been the provisional budget. So I asked the minister, would he acknowledge that many ministers are saying they're now making cuts, but these are not the cuts that I would have made if I had a choice, but these are the very limited choices that I can make by making unplanned in-year cuts, which is the most inefficient way to make cuts and savings in any government department?
Mr Deputy Speaker, I'll try to address the point a bit. In terms of making adjustments to the budget, that would necessitate, because there's no new money, okay? There's no more money coming from London. I presume that the member doesn't want to substantially increase rates, not that it raises a huge amount of money anyway. I'm presuming the party still holds the position of opposing water charges. So we don't have any new money to play with. Money has to then come from existing budgets. And I don't hear anything coming from the member or any of his party colleagues about where we would find the money from to move to health or education or indeed any other budget that might be deemed as a priority. So there's nothing, you know, you can ask about new budget processes as you did yesterday with a terribly worded motion which called for a redrafting of a budget for 3 months of the year, showing a complete lack of understanding of the budgetary process in this House. But the fundamental point is, even if you do redraft the budget, you need to have money to do something substantially different with it from. And I hear nothing coming from the Ulster Unionist benches, or indeed any benches in this House, about where we would find the money to do things radically different or indeed better in terms of our budget.
Order, time is up.